bright and early with the birds as our beautiful soundtrack, which seems rather fitting. So I just would like to take a moment to thank some people that are very important to the festival, and I have a little bit of housekeeping before we start the session. So the festival is really proud to present Z Entertainment as our title partner, and Nexa, who's come on board for the first time as our associate partner. And I'd just like to list some of our venue partners to say a special thank you to Rachel Killachand and the Bank of Baroda, JCP Prize for Literature, Bookstore managed by Full Circle, and our cause partner Detol Banega Swatch India, Black and White, who are our celebrations partner. And thank you so much to Jan Michalski, the Aga Khan Foundation, the Getty Foundation, the J. Paul Getty Trust, British Council, Nordic Lights, Mahindra World City, Dove, Airtel, Kingfisher, Grover, CK Birla Hospitals, Avid Learning, and for everybody for believing in this festival and for their continued support. It means a lot. Our new partners this year are Population Foundation of India, Child Free Labour Jaipur, DMI Finance, Dell, Sun Village, Air India, Ola, O2 Sparkle, and Swami. And our publishers, thank you so much to Penguin, MIT Press, Westland, Oxford Dictionaries, Murti Classical Library of India, Harvard University Press, and HarperCollins. I'm nearly done. The future of every festival depends on these growing relationships and with existing and new audiences such as yourselves. So we'd also just like to thank our media partners, Red FM and Rajasthan's very own Patrika Group, Baksar Group for their generous support year after year, and our new partners, Business Standard, Outlook and DNA. And finally, our social media partners who are really important. Obviously, Facebook and Twitter has been increasing our reach to the world, but thanks to Vayuz, Wattpad and Launchora, who are our podcast partner. And don't forget to tweet hashtag ZJLF 2019 or the handle at ZJLF. Okay, without further ado, there's a couple of little announcements as well, just to let you know. If you don't know where the nearest bathroom, ladies and gents, is literally just in between this and the Batak venue. This little walkway here leads straight to the toilets just here if you need them. If there's any problems with first aid, as you came in under the beautiful arch before you got to all of the beautiful display, all the colorful colors, there is a first aid tent there if you need anything, or please do speak to our wonderful staff who you'll see around if you do need any help with anything. We have a really strong policy about any sort of harassment, which will just not be tolerated. So if anybody feels that they have been badly treated or if there's any problem at all, please do come speak to us. Or there are police who are around the venue, and there is a police desk if you do feel the need to report something. Please don't leave any bags unattended, because that can be a big security risk and that would be much appreciated. And really, really important, if everyone could please, at this moment, turn your phones to silent. It's such a huge, important aspect of respect for our authors and our speakers. So everybody, please, right now, get your phones out, all on silent, please. And if you do receive a call that's very important and urgent, just take it outside. That's all we ask. Just please don't have any conversations in here while our speakers are in the middle of their wonderful insights and comments and discussions. So, no flash photography, which isn't particularly relevant at the moment, and just keeping our aisles free. And lastly, there is a wonderful festival bazaar going on and pool bazaar, which you might have seen yesterday. They are full of the most wonderful artisans, young entrepreneurs, and people that we really want to support. So if you have a few extra rupees and you want to go and have a little spend up, please go and visit the bazaars. So that brings me to announcing our wonderful next session. Welcome, welcome to It's a Dog's Life. We have two wonderful authors joining us today, Kunzang Choden and Manjeet Hirani, and they will be in conversation with Timmie Kumar. Now, just to tell you a quick bit about Timmie before they come on stage, she is passionate about animals and she's the founder of Animal Lovers Association in Agra, and she worked there for 10 years before moving here to Jaipur. She's a managing trustee of Help in Suffering, and she's won many awards for her work around the world here in Rajasthan. So please, if you could join me in welcoming our authors and our moderator to the stage. Thank you so much. Have a wonderful day. Kamagani.
Hello. Hello. Good morning, everybody, and especially all our friends from Jaipur and all the other friends from all over. I know we all are dog lovers, and that's why we're all here. I would like to welcome Kunzang Choden from Bhutan, who's an amazing lady who was the first Bhutanese lady to study English and come to India to do her college, one of the first few who've written, in fact, the first lady who's written a book in English from Bhutan and has done many wonderful things there. Besides, she's working in a village now. She was also a director in the Bhutan Literary Festival. She loves nature. She's done a lot of work in the past with the United Nations, with the street dogs in Bhutan. She also is now living in her village and working with organic vegetable growing and working with all the villagers and teaching the youngsters. She's written several books for children on Bhutanese folktales in English. Right? And now I'd like to introduce Manjeet Hirani. Manjeet Hirani has an amazing story to a young lady who was an air hostess in Indian Airlines, had a passion for flying, and then she went to study flying abroad. And now she's a pilot, and she's a lady pilot trainer. She's a senior pilot and is training a lot of younger women to fly. Manjeet is also, and Manjeet has written her first book, Buddy, on a dog. A person who disliked dogs has written her how she changed from a dog disliker to a dog lover. And Manjeet continues to write. I think she's going to be soon writing another book on her flying career, right? And she's a philosopher. So should I now ask our first speaker, Kunzang? Kunzang, your book, Dawa, the story of a dog in the streets of Bhutan, a stray dog. It's a very different sort of a subject. And how did you think of writing a book on something so kind of, you know, you would normally write something on a dog who's next door or is part of your family. Would you like to tell us something about it and read something from, and this book is fabulous because I've read it, and it's on a journey of a dog who's almost instinctively spiritually inclined, right?
Hello. Thanks so much for the question. Why did I write about a dog? Now, I think anyone who's been to Bhutan will realize very soon that people and dogs have a very fluid kind of a relationship. We don't have dogs that have, you know, they are pets, they're kept in their apartments and houses, or dogs. We do not separate them as being dogs outside the house and who are not cared for. We live with dogs all the time. But one of the main reasons why I was inspired to write about a dog is that I live in central Bhutan, which is about, in the old days, about 10 to 12 hours drive. And I used to do this journey very often from the capital, Thimphu. And when you sit in the car for hours and then suddenly on the top of 4,000 meters, you see a dog, very determined, very purposeful, making a journey, you wonder where they're going and what they're doing. And these dogs look like they, you know, they have a very important meeting, and they just put up their tails like a banner announcing themselves, and they just walk on, you know, without even taking a care. And that sort of inspired me that dogs seem to have a purpose in their lives. They know where they're going and what they're doing. And, you know, in Thimphu, which is the capital city where most of the visitors come, most of the international organizations live, dogs is an issue. Because we have so many dogs that some of the hotels actually provide earplugs because they bark in the night. Then you try to look out, which is this dog that disturbed me last night? You can't identify them because all the dogs look so peaceful, sleeping everywhere, but let the night fall and they're up and about barking. And I've even heard about visitors who come to Bhutan who change hotels every day because they think they can get away from the dogs, but you can't get away from the dogs. So this, and I felt we have to nurture a special respect for dogs because they are part of our lives. Thank you.
Thank you. Manjeet?
Hello. Yeah. Manjeet, we'd like you to share with the audience how, from a person who disliked dogs, and how you dissuaded your young son not to have a pet dog at home. And then you were landed with a dog who you finally love and have written a book on. Could you talk about that, please?
Good morning, everyone. You can hear me? Good morning. Thank you. That's an amazing story of Dawa. And what she has written is the spiritual journey of a dog. In my case, my book is actually a philosophical journey of a dog. So I was born with fear of dogs. And stray dogs, I get very, very, very scared. Even there's a dog in somebody's house, I would make sure that the dog is tied up or I will not go. So my son, as he was growing, he wanted a dog so badly, but because of my fear, it was a complete no-no. And my husband is a filmmaker. He made a film, PK. It was released in 2014. So he had a little pup in the film. And after the shoot got over, the pup was supposed to go back to the breeder. But he thought, you know, my son loves a dog so much, why not I give them as a surprise gift? So he put it in a basket and put some flowers around, and it came to our house in the evening as a surprise gift. So when the pup came, it was just 6 weeks old. And it was very innocent, and I thought it was very harmless. And the joy I saw in my son's face, I said, you know, I'm sure I can change my mind. But for many, many weeks, I didn't do anything. I didn't even pet him or something. And my son, you know, I have this dog. Mom, I'll take care of him. You don't have to worry. I'll do everything. Probably he did that for 1 or 2 days, and then, you know, he was a school-going kid. And so the charge came on me, because it's not only bringing a dog and playing with the dog, you know, there's so much of responsibility. Immunizations and food and veterinary doctors and everything. So I had to take the charge. So after a few months, I said, why not take the dog for a walk? Actually, for me, it was a very stylish thing. Take him on the leash. I've seen a lot of people doing that. And I've seen the guys from the army with a stick in the hand. And, you know, I always find that very stylish, actually. I said, today I'll do that. I had no clue. I've never studied about the nature, the character, what happens, how to bring up a dog. I was clueless. I leave my house. And I go outside my where we live, take a right turn. After some time, I see several dogs pouncing at us, the stray dogs. I got so scared that day, I was in tears. And there were some women passing by. I said, please help me, please help me. And many guys. So they were, you know, carrying hay on their heads. They all surrounded me. I was inside them. And I said, please drop me home. But I must admit one thing. My little fellow, who was hardly 3-4 months old, was barking back at them. As if he's a stud, you know. And I was so petrified. I came home. I spoke to my friend in the evening. I said, oh my God, I'm so scared to go out, you know. So she said, no, next time you do one thing, don't go that side, but you go on the other side near the school, there are no dogs. I said, okay. Next day I went again. So as I went to the school, till a point, there were no dogs. But when I crossed the road, again many dogs came charging me, at me. I quickly crossed the road, then they stopped when I came home. So that was the first thought I had that kept me, this thing that dogs are very territorial. You know, if you enter the territory, they bark at you. The minute you're out of the territory, they don't care. So that's the first blog I wrote, actually, territorial. Then I wrote subsequently blogs as he was growing up. Actually, my book is in a very chronological order. Whatever I made my observations, I kept writing about that. Next was about puberty, how he was growing, and my son was 14 that time, and the dog also was hitting his puberty. So I felt I could relate both of them, you know? So, but I was saying with the dogs and animals, it's so natural, you know. And we say, oh, he's hitting puberty. You see him at the sofa, at the cushions, at the guests. You don't mind it, you know. But you can't imagine that with your children, if, you know. And anything happens, I think we'll send them to a psychologist and they're perverts and, you know, absolutely no. And we'll be like watchguards with them. So these are my experiences as and when the Buddy was growing. We named him Buddy. As and when he was growing, the experiences I went through.
Would you like to tell them about why you've compared it similarly about the puberty? How in the olden days, why did they get their daughters married or children married young? I thought that was a very well kind of related, the whole instance. Would you like to talk a little bit on that?
Yeah, in my chapter, puberty, I've mentioned the thing. What I felt was, you know, there's a certain age for everything. It's nature. It's absolutely nature. The way I saw with Buddy, that after 6 months or 1 year, he was hitting puberty. And earlier, I said in India, you know, we used to have child marriages. Now, absolutely, it's a no-no. I'm not in favor of child marriages or something. I'm just giving an example that how things were done, that the kids were small. The boy and the girl, they would get married. And when they hit puberty, they call it gona. Like, you know, then you can go and live together. So I feel their sexual requirements were taken care of at a young age. But now what happens is all of us, even I got married at the age of 29. So, but we choose to get married late because we want to have a career, we want to educate ourselves. But I feel it's nature that your body clock is ticking, you know. It's nature. So, but as a culture, we say, okay, if you're married, you can have sex. But if you're not married, you could be 30, you could be 35, but you can't have sex. So that doesn't gel with me, you know, because I feel it's nature. Leave it to nature. Youngsters, they know what they're doing. Respect them. That is the point I have mentioned in my chapter, Puberty.
What is interesting is in both the books is that there is a lesson for humans to be learned. Kunzang, I would like to ask you, the book shows how life of Dawa living on the streets and the survival instincts and what power and how he becomes the leader of the howling pack and how other dogs he has, like in humans, when become leaders or ministers, you have followers. Some of them are kind, some of them are just psychophants. And that's exactly how Dawa's life you portrayed. And the two dogs, Mole, the female dog, and Dampa, the wise old dog, who play a very important role on, you know, kind of making him think and move on. Would you like to talk on that, please?
My book about this dog called Dawa is not only just about dogs, but how dogs perceive human beings. And Bhutan is a very small society where everybody knows everybody. And if you write something about somebody, you know. In fact, when I first published my book, everybody, did you write about me? Am I mentioned in your book? You know, that kind of a society. It's a very small society. So I took Dawa, my dog, to be looking at the human society. And as a dog, I give him permission to say what he likes about the society. So, he experiences what it was to be kind of an abandoned orphan who's riddled with mange and how he slowly climbs up the power ladder until he becomes a leader. And he works very hard. In fact, he even looks in a little pool to see how he should position himself, what kind of a family lineage he should build up, and he makes himself an extraordinary dog, and he wants to be. He's completely taken in by the idea of being the leader of the howling packs in Thimphu. And then once he reaches that level, he has a beautiful voice, so he can howl and wake up all the dogs in the vicinity, and they howl together. But once he wakes up from his dream of being the leader, he begins to think that there is something very fraught, very dangerous, very artificial about being in that position. And then he begins to reflect on, is this what I really want? Should I continue? Because all the people who are around me, who are my psycho fans, will actually, they're all looking at my position. That's what the dog realizes. And just in time, he realizes that, you know, I'm going to quit. I'm going to abdicate. And he moves away quietly. And I think for leaders to do that, it's quite fantastic. And now if I think about it, actually even our king, who was just not even 60, he abdicated in favor of his son. And I think that's never happened. And I think that relates also to how Bhutanese think. The king just said, now I'm tired, I'm ready to abdicate in favor of my son. So at the time I wrote the book, there was no talk about the king abdicating. I wrote the book in 2005, and the king abdicated much later. But it's similar. I think that the Bhutanese, you know, enough. You know, I've had enough. Now it's time to move on into another. So this was, I think, what I tried to show.
I think that's beautiful, because Bhutan is like that. And in that couple of short visits I had there, I would say that it is really a country to visit. And people actually live with nature and respect nature and each other. And people have a lot of respect for all humans, all visitors. I think maybe because they've just been trained and they take great pride in their language, their stories, their country. You know, so I'm absolutely a great fan of Bhutan.
Thank you.
But meanwhile, I'd like to relate a little story about my own little experience in working with animals, and especially with the charity of Help and Suffering for 18, 19 years. Every time there were pups, and you know, because we have a lot of money coming from international donors, and you know, and we have brilliant veterinary doctors, Indian and international, they do believe in euthanizing animals which are sick or which cannot move around, whereas our Indian philosophy is just beyond thinking of euthanizing animals. And so every time there were like a bunch of puppies, and they would say, oh, the best thing is to put them down because one by one they'll all die. Mm-hmm. I just felt that being the head of the organization, that time I was a co-managing trustee with my Australian counterpart. And I said, I couldn't sleep the whole night, and I said, I must bring these puppies home and, you know, try and nurture them. So she said, no point, they're going to die one by one. One of the best vets, he told us that, Timmie, don't waste time. I said, no, what's the use of serving if I'm not going to try? I brought them home. One, of course, was terribly sick, and they barely opened their eyes. And then I took it as a challenge, and for that, it was more like showing them that, no, I can save them. And I'm honestly telling you that if you put that first foot forward, and they were all street dogs, and they all got saved, all 14 of them. And most of them, I would pray to God every morning. I said, please get them adopted. So finally, people came and started adopting. But one was the ugliest and the, you know, most mischievous. Nobody would have her. And then I decided that maybe she's meant to come to me, and I already had 2-3 other dogs. So with reluctance, I thought I'll gift it to my husband as a gift. And that was the best thing to do. Every time being stuck with dogs, I said, this is Valentine's gift, this is birthday gift. So, and then my driver said, madam, iska naam Ram Pyari Rakhte. She's the God's favorite one.
Oh.
That's, And we had this driver who'd been with us for several years, so we kept Ram Pyari. And Ram, and we lived on the fifth floor, my husband's a hotelier of the hotel. And my son, it was Arjun, who kind of brought her once from the gym. She just followed him upstairs because she used to run around the whole garden. And we kept her with our guard with the house we were building. And then she never left my house. She was in the apartment. She would go into the guest room, eat breakfast with them. She would be sitting. And she was this funny-looking dog who suddenly became very fat later. And Ram Pyari was actually my lucky charm. I think our hotel did better and better thereafter. So I would, every time my husband say, oh, she's running around and the guests don't like her. I said, to hell, let the guests who don't like shift into another hotel. We don't want people who don't love dogs, right? So Ram Pyari really became the Pyari of every. We had guests from France who'd come every year and they say, they'd come specially to see Ram Pyari, you know? So there were some people who'd written hate comments, some who had written beautiful comments, the best thing about the hotel is the dog. And now, and Ram Pyari lived for 13 years, and you know, she had such a peaceful death. And she was an amazing intel. When I got brought in other puppies, she would take care of them, and she was the alpha dog. Mm. So I know what dogs do to all of us. But now I'd like Manjeet to take over and tell us about, you know, how dogs are not, they do not discriminate at all, right? And how they play such an important, whether you love them or not, whether you keep them outdoors when guests come, but they're always there for you. Manjeet, would you like to tell us and read something from the book, please?
Before I read, actually every dog has its own personality. What she's talking about, Ram Pyari, is a different story. What I read about Dawa is a different story, a different personality. My dog Buddy has got its own personality. He's a Cocker Spaniel. And one thing that I have learned, he's with us for 6 years now, this is the sixth year going on, is that it's not that Buddy is always, you know, very happy-go-lucky and he's always happy with whatever we do. He's a very naughty, not and very hyper dog. And when some guests come over to our place, so many of the guests they detest because he goes all over them and licks them. So many people don't like. So that's the time we ask Buddy to leave the room. And he's so reluctant, so hesitant. He'll be on the ground like a stone. You can't even pick him up, you know. So then we cheat on him. We get him some chicken sticks or something, something. And we ask him to go. He goes with reluctance that I'm not happy. You guys are sitting and gossiping and discussing politics. I want to be part of it. But we ask him to go. Then he's gone. When the guests have gone, then we ask him to come back. But when he comes back, he's forgotten everything. Okay. Completely how we treated him. And he comes with the same gusto, wagging his tail. Because I can't imagine if my husband has asked me to leave and then I come back happily smiling, wow, you know. I'll at least not talk to him for a couple of days and at least shout back at him. So that's one quality I actually... I'm trying to imbibe in myself. I would say I've managed it. Because I keep looking at Buddy and I said, this is one thing I have to learn from him. I just forget. That was in that moment. And now coming and meeting the person is this moment. So this is one great quality or part of is my learning. So from my book, I would like to read the introduction, which was written by my son because the dog came for him. So this will tell the whole story of the book. My son's name is Veer Hirani, and he's 20 years old. This he wrote when he was 3-4 years back. Being a hopeless dog lover, I had always wanted a pup. However, this yearning was never fulfilled because of two reasons that my parents threw at me. Honestly, I didn't even consider them to be that big a deal. The first was that our apartment was too small to accommodate a dog. In brackets, he's written, as if dogs in pet shops don't actually live in cages before finding a home. And secondly, dogs scared the living hell out of my mom. No arguments there. Well, I tried to move on. I explained to myself that it was not my parents, but me who was at fault. I just had my way too many expectations. I wiped my tears trying to accept this until we shifted to a bigger house, large enough to accommodate a dog, or even an elephant for that matter. Since the latter was out of bounds, I prepared a strong case to get a dog, ready to be presented to my parents. This, I believe, would finally put an end to my indulgence in self-pity. However, all my hopes were flushed down the drain when I learned that the second factor had still remained unchanged. Dogs still scared the living hell out of my mom. Short-run problems, I guess. Incidentally, a year later, my father needed a pup for a scene in his film PK. Remember the dog that wanted to commit suicide? That's a character of the dog in the film. Don't tell me that you haven't seen the movie. My father will find you and haunt you till you watch it. So if you guys haven't watched it, please watch it now. Anyway, since the scene revolved around a suicidal dog, Dad's team launched a full-fledged search to find the most depressed-looking dog. That's the reason Cocker Spaniel was chosen. The kind that would make you say, "Oh," at the first sight. One that would evoke a stabbing sense of sympathy, even in the most cold-blooded individual. The kind that would make you feel an irresistible urge to hug the person next to you. After a tremendous hunt, right before everyone touched the peak of insanity with these demanding criteria, Dad's team found the archetypal dog. His ears were longer than his face. His ruby eyes made him look terribly sad. He had a white patch above his nose, and that was the called for immediate pity. He named Niku, the Cocker Spaniel in PK. Over the next few days, the crew fell in love with him. I would hear about this dog incessantly and eagerly waited for relief from school to go on the sets and meet him. I did not have to wait long. One evening, the doorbell rang. I opened the door to the blank space, wondering if I had been pranked or it was my ears were ringing. To my surprise, I noticed a cushioned basket on the floor in which Nigu lay peacefully. There was a note that read, "A dog is man's best friend. Have fun with him. He's your son." As it turned out, it wasn't just the crew that had fallen in love with Niku. My dad too had succumbed to his charm. My reactions to this note was even more dramatic than Niku's entry in our lives. I was crying like Nirupa Roy and laughing like Johnny Lever. These are two characters from Hindi films. All at the same time. I was ecstatic, overjoyed, and euphoric. I barely let anyone take a satisfying glance at him. In my mother's case, she didn't care. Soon, Nick became buddy to the justice to a dog's venerated character as man's best friend. But more importantly, he was renamed because I didn't want to be reminded of the depressed dog in PK. Buddy is the complete opposite of the dog he portrayed in the film. He's not a depressed dog. In fact, he's an antidepressant. His cheerfulness was evident in all his shenanigans, which made my mom started capturing on her phone camera, but from a minimum distance of 5 feet. Before I knew, with all the time she spent together, mom grew comfortable in his company. Finally, the divine day came when she took the bold step of petting him. Despite feeling icky afterwards and sprinting away like Usain Bolt, she enjoyed her little adventure. With the amount of affection Buddy showered on everyone, one was certain to fall in love with him. It took time with mom, but the unthinkable happened. Today, she cannot imagine a day when she doesn't share her morning chai with Buddy. I'm both proud and hesitant to say that her love for Buddy might be greater than mine. After all, she's writing her first book on him. What else can express her love better? It wouldn't be too much to say that Buddy has indeed changed her life. All other dogs, however, continue to scare the living hell out of her. And I must add one thing, that I'm not scared of Buddy, but I'm still scared of other dogs. I've come to the house and they have a big dog and I said, "Oh God, please tie him up," you know.
You know, what you said about dogs, it's so true, because they said the only creature on this earth who loves his master, who loves you more than himself, is a dog. And I'm sure all the people who own dogs would agree on that. But Kunzang, I would like you to read something which you'd like to share with the audience. Because both the books are really worth reading. And Kunzang's journey is almost philosophical and literally a spiritual journey of a dog, as Manjeet told us. I think both of us completely agree that it's Very, very beautifully written book.
Thank you. I'll read a small bit of the chapter called The Underdog. That's when Dawa has been the leader, and he's now reflecting on whether this is what he really wanted. Dawa had been a leader for a long time now, but he never felt the sense of satisfaction that he had expected when he achieved his dream of leadership. Had pursued the wrong dream? In fact, once at the top, he saw that his position was a precarious one. He was in the highest echelons of dog power, but being a member of the leadership was fraught with danger, and it required him to work with the dogs who were certainly not his choice of companions. How he wished for his old friend, Mole, was there to guide him. Dampa was always amused by his pleas for counsel. He kept insisting, "What now? You got what you wanted." The three most powerful leaders were the dog of territories, the leader of warnings and signals, and the leader of howling. Dawa soon realized that he had put up with the aggressive and uncouth leader of territories, whose job was to protect the territory and chase away all dogs that did not belong to the area. The area extended from the Dzong down to the National Hospital and the lower Motithang to the vegetable market. Dawa quickly learned that definition of leader, territories changed with each leader. The changing boundaries were the cause of endless dog wars. There were ruthless physical fights when the most terrible of canine sounds would be emitted, and sometimes blood was drawn. And worse still, once in a while, even lives were lost. After a war, the leader of territories could be then seen bespattered with blood and licking his paws with the twisted smile of satisfaction on his face. I think that's all I'll read.
Thank you. Thank you, I think. We have questions and answers now, if you'd like to have, because session's about to end in the next 10 minutes. So anything you'd like to...
We do have.
Oh, great. Okay, that's great. So we have more to share. You know, we're talking about dog characteristics, and I have millions of stories to share since kind of I worked with animal protection, and we had this dog. We still have this dog in the animal shelter called Bonnie, you know, which is a very strange-looking dog, just like how you described Dawa, but little different. Mm-hmm. And she's a female dog, and she stays at Help and Suffering at Durgapura, and she doesn't like to be with dogs. She spends all her time in the equine kennel and the bovine kennel. So she gets herself scratched by the donkeys, the mules, and she gets into the food trough, and she's there. During the summer months, she gets into the water trough. And she just doesn't like to be. We've separated her, but she spends the whole day. And I really wonder about past lives, whether she was a mule or something in her past, because she just doesn't like to be with any other animal but the mules. Do you have such experiences to tell us? Have you experienced something about strange qualities of dogs?
In fact, we believe in the concept of reincarnations, and I make Dawa, you know, we believe in the cycle of births, yeah, that you're in a, based on how you've lived your life, you're born again as, you know, at higher levels, and finally a human being. But in my story, I made Dawa the reincarnation of a translator. Because then he can say, so from a human to a dog. And we usually believe that once you're a dog, the next step is human beings. So I just changed it from human beings to becoming a dog, because that's also possible. So that's why Dawa has this gift of listening and hearing and understanding all languages. So he's beyond language barriers.
Yeah, I think that's a very important you know, point in the book, which is there because of his being a linguist almost, a linguist dog, who can understand, who can also speak, but doesn't like to speak because he doesn't want to frighten people.
Because his speech comes out in bows and wows and woofs, you know, so people can't understand, but he can understand people,
Manjeet, would you like to share anything else with us?
I have to say the things that the things which are very common with dogs and humans, like one of his chapter I've written on depression, that once we all got very busy when actually the film was releasing and we completely ignored Buddy, completely, because we were so busy in our own lives. So we used to see him sitting very quiet, and we actually thought he was sick, and we got very worried. Actually, he has more doctor visits than my son. So anything happens, we don't judge, you know, we straight away take him to the doctor. Then we realized the doctor told us he's into depression because he was ignored. So that is a time, you know, this is how I've drawn my parallels, that, you know, if any person is ignored, be it the senior citizens or anyone, humans, even a dog, even animals, they get into depression. So how human interaction and giving constant attention to each other is so important. But I was very intrigued because I love this reincarnation stories. And I always wonder whether it is true, you know. I still have my question mark, you know. So when I read your book, I said, there's so much of faith and it can be true.
But, you know, Kunzang, like you said about the healing power, how he healed himself at the end. And he was instinctively healing himself because he went to seek that, where that lady, Permo. You know, would you like to elaborate something on that?
I come from a very, quite a far village from the center. So people who've been to Bhutan, they visit the capital and the western part, and not many people come to the central Bhutan. And my village is actually in a place which we call the end of the world because it doesn't go from there any beyond there. But we have a lot of folk stories and semi-historical stories. And there is a story about a 12th century Kashmiri princess who actually had, she was afflicted with leprosy. And then, of course, in those days, there was no cure for leprosy. So she sort of moved further and further away from home till she reached the Himalayas, the Bhutanese part of the Himalayas. And there she's made quite a lot of landmark because even now, including in my village, we follow her tradition of curing yourself through fasting and silence. And one and a half hours walk from my actual home, there is a cave where she's supposed to have meditated and healed herself of leprosy through fasting and meditation. And every year, once a year, this temple, which is quite close to this cave, holds that. So the story is that Dawa hears about this just by chance, and he said, if she can cure herself of leprosy, I'm sure I can cure myself from mange. So it's a journey from central Bhutan to my valley, where he goes and looks for this cave and he meditates. He doesn't meditate, but he sits in the cave believing that he will get cured. And he does get cured. So it's the power of faith. And it just disappeared. His mange just disappeared. He'd never seen a vet. He's never applied any kind of salve or taken medicine, but just through the faith that he will get cured, he gets cured.
You know, I completely agree with what you're saying and your belief, because I've experienced it that once I was detected with some illness, which was quite dire. But I remember when I was being taken for my surgery, I just prayed to my dogs and my animals. I said, if I've done something right for you, you will protect me and believe you in me. When I came out of the surgery, my doctor said, it's all clear, you can go home. So honestly, the animals, if you really care for them, they heal you. They take a lot of your pain away from you. And I just really agree with, you know, what you're in Bhutan, what you believe in, and we do in India as well. We would now open the house for question and answers if you'd like to talk, ask. Yeah, thank you. Could you stand up and let us know your name and...
If you don't mind, can I say it? I've got a leg pain. Tashidele! My name is Dr. Jaikishan Padhi. I'm a mental environment therapist. My first question is to the all of you. If you know about the menace that's caused by stray dogs, what's your view on that? The other question.
All right. One question.
Both questions are kind of important, so I don't know which one to select.
All right.
The second one is how to deal with loss of a dog and how to help someone who's going through that. I have a lot of patients coming to me. Talking about it, I'm shivering within because I'm reminded of my Rottweiler. How to deal with a loss.
The first question is how you
deal with stray dogs.
How you deal with stray dogs. I think in general in Bhutan, stray dogs are there. They're welcomed, and everybody. We have a lot of stray dogs, and people feed them and sort of name them. But they are not your pet dogs. They live in their own territories, and it's only now that there are 2-3 people who have actually taken the trouble and formed a kind of a association to make sure that they're vaccinated, they're neutered. And if you go to Thimphu, you can be very safe if you're bitten by a dog whose ear has been a little bit chipped off because they have been vaccinated and neutered. So there is a movement that just, it's not enough just to feed them, but you have to take care of them also. And if they have problems like mange or something else that they have been treated. But once in a while, you will see one that's really in terrible condition. And then you just report them to these 2-3 associations that they will look after them. With loss, I don't know if you'd, with losing.
Yeah, I'll talk about the loss because I've covered a chapter on death. Mm-hmm. So, since I was not a dog lover, as I said, and I had a friend of mine who lost a dog, and when the dog died, you know, they said, we have kept a havan in a house and we are going to make a memorial of the dog in a farmhouse. Frankly, that time I thought they're overdoing it, you know. I couldn't relate to it, you know. Now that I have a dog in my house, it's my first dog and I'm sure their lifespan, whatever the lifespan is. So I've covered this chapter because death means it's not only of a pet, death is of a family man, person. I lost my father very young. And I've seen a lot of deaths in the families, close friends. And so to me, I look at it, now that I've learned from Buddy also, that it's the moment, you know, which is important. Now that whatever years he's going to live with me, I have to capture those moments, spend as much time, not hold any grudges, be with my husband, with my mother, with anyone, because the moments are very precious. So once you have that, and, you know, death will happen eventually to everyone, to all of us. So when the person is no more, you should not have any guilt in you that, oh, I wish I had done this. I wish I had spent more time with the person. I wish I had not said this to the person. So because I've seen when the person is no more, you only think of those things. I wish I could have, you know, a close, my grandmother died and I was supposed to visit, but I couldn't visit. But I have this regret. I wish I had gone. Was my flight so important? I could have not gone on my flight. So you should not have the regrets. So, but loss will happen eventually.
That's so true. Hello, yeah.
Good morning, ma'am. So what do you think about reincarnation of stray dogs?
Well, my book, sorry, I'll take this older version.
Yeah.
It's the story of a stray dog, and I've written the stray as an, as a second thought. And I think for us, we are so quick. We cannot think unless we label somebody. You know, you're a school kid, you're a this, you're that, I'm an old woman with white. We always label people. So for us, stray dogs are capable of being reincarnated. I mean, everyone is on the chain of reincarnations, and irrespective of whether you're male, child, puppy, big dog, old human being, young human being, we all have the chance to be reincarnated. And that's why we have to treat everyone with respect.
You know, I would like to just talk on that because it's very important for young children to realize, firstly, never fear, no animal will attack you unless he's threatened or you're kind of invading if he's eating food or sick. So if you can't be kind, don't be cruel. Just ignore, be away. But I must let everyone know that Jaipur is one of the probably only cities in the country which has done an animal birth control for more than 75 to 80,000 dogs by the organization which I've associated with. They started this birth control program 19 years ago, one of the first few cities, and immunization against rabies. We've also done a little program in Thimphu with Humane Society. So it's an ongoing program. We almost have very few dogs now to capture. But if you get bitten by a dog here, you can be dead sure that you will not get rabies. Because they've all been, the ears have been clipped in the corner, and every year, and they mark them with this permanent ink so that you know exactly what date they're done. And it's done very systematically by a very competent veterinary doctor from England and India in tandem. And they have written many research papers on it, and they're respected, have been awarded internationally. So we do have some great animal work being done here. We also rescue street dogs, cows, camels. This is probably one of the charities in India which does all the animals, right from a little sparrow to an elephant. But we're not doing the elephant project anymore because we don't have the funds, but we are there if required. But we are fighting against captive elephants. I know it's not the subject, but I thought just expand a bit. Would anyone like to ask any more questions, please?
The lady in the yellow, is there?
And the lady right here as well.
So yeah.
And then the yellow, yeah.
No, the lady in the yellow.
And then after that, you.
The young boy here.
Hello. I have, I'm a dog lover and I adopt stray dogs. So, what's your advice as to, you know, getting more stray dogs, but at the same time getting them adopted?
I would say that yes, I have five stray dogs, and I must tell you that they are far more hardy, they are very affectionate, very intelligent, and in fact, I also have adopted somebody's beagle who was being transferred. She's a gorgeous dog, but she is very greedy. But my stray dogs will not eat more than what they are given or what they feel like eating. She could eat anything under the earth. You know, so I must say it's lovely to get them adopted, as many. And I think we should adopt because buying pedigree dogs in climate like Rajasthan and looking after them is a challenge. And a lot of people get them, buy them, but can't take care of them. And when they get sick, they leave them on the street. We are, as running an animal hospital, we are constantly laden with pedigree dogs who are in terrible condition. It's very, very sad. Because you can leave street dogs back on the streets because they have the survival instincts. But pedigree dogs, once you've kept them at home and leave them, they can't survive. They get killed by other dogs. So please think before you buy or adopt. It's very important. I had to spay my beagle because I was scared that not everybody will look after her well. So I've got all my dogs spayed and neutered. It's not the nicest thing to do, but I have done it. Thank you.
Good morning. So my question is that only dogs have a better understanding level or other animals have, because I have a rabbit in my house named Stella. So she always understands us, but sometimes we are unable to understand her. So
how sweet.
So sometimes she does any actions or anything to understand, to make us understand what she wants to say. So my question is that only dogs have a better understanding level or other animals also have a better understanding level?
Yeah, all, most animals have, because they all have instinctively, most animals have understanding. Cows understand, horses understand, there are people who, you know, horse whisperer.
Yeah.
Who can, so a lot of animals, by your touch and love, all animals can understand how you breathe. You know, the more love you give, the more, the better they respond to you. What would you like to say?
Don't try that with a tiger.
Yeah, I think that's it.
You were going to say something, yeah, please.
Hi, thank you for the session. My name is Shruti, and I have a question for both the authors and also you, Timmie. So we recently got our poodle splayed. She was lactating because of hormonal imbalance. And then we soon realized that it really changed the way we now eat, and it changed our lifestyle in a very tangible way, that we no longer feel like consuming milk from any animal. I'm just curious, in this session we spoke a lot about the intangible things of having pets, especially dogs, of empathy or having no regrets. The philosophical side of it. I'm curious how it changed your lives, because you work so closely with animals and also you're so close to your dogs. If you can share a little bit about what are the tangible things in your life that has impacted you.
Would you like to speak, Kunzang?
I've always had pet dogs, but I've always extended my affection and my respect for dogs all around. How, after I wrote the book Dawa, I begin to get recognized by especially young people as the, you know, the author of Dawa. And that's because Dawa got, this book got, is being used as a textbook in most schools. So every child, those who have reached level 9 have read the book. And now I'm recognized not by myself, but as the creator of Dawa. So that's been the big change. You know, I'm sometimes even people call me Dawa's mother.
How lovely.
Yeah, so that's.
Manjeet, would you like to?
Yeah, okay. One thing I would like to add is, you know, I've seen this, I've learned through, again, Buddy, that I used to always wonder why he barks at certain people and why he doesn't bark. You know, he doesn't bark at every person who comes to the house. So, first of all, they bark at people who don't like him or who are scared of him. So he can sense that, absolutely. So even I feel your inner feelings, we might think something about a person, we might not like the person, but we pretend to like the person. I think the other person judges and we scent our vibes, because Buddy catches the vibes. So I think you have to be very transparent. Extremely transparent.
And you know, you're talking about lactation. I completely, you know, because I've been working with animal protection and, you know, gone into a lot of details of what happens behind the curtains. My family who's sitting here, they've all, my husband and my, two of my boys have turned vegan. I'm 80% vegan. And my family is complete vegetarian. And earlier, my husband used to love his fish. 3 years back, he turned vegan. 5 years ago, he turned vegetarian. And I've been mad for him for 34 years, but it took him a long time. But I feel one should. And a lot of my friends, and I feel, you know, she loved her chicken, and she said she's turned into a vegetarian. So I feel the whole world is going through a journey. And unfortunately, we never get exposed to what's going on behind the scenes. I wouldn't say I'm 100%, but I'm 80% vegan. But my husband is, I would say, 95%. We've given up wearing leather, buying what we have, but, you know, I still use what I have. Don't want to be a hypocrite, but as much as possible, being more sensitive, and that's what's led us to But I feel everybody's on their journey, and it's not that if you do eat or don't eat, doesn't make a difference, as long as you feel right about what you do.
I think I read one beautiful line somewhere, you know, that about the dogs only. You know, there's a big campaign going on about killing the stray dogs and all that. So I read a beautiful line, ki, this planet belongs to everyone.
So true, very beautiful.
Because we human beings think it's our planet, but this planet belongs to everyone. So respect everyone.
Yeah, would you like to? Yeah. Oh, please. Hi. One last two questions. Okay, please.
Hi, my name is Aisha. I'm from Bangalore. So in South, in Bangalore, we have a very, you know, strong animal care and, you know, the whole culture is such that we have a cat squad as well as, you know, organizations that support dogs as well. Mm-hmm. And even when the Kerala floods happened, a lot of volunteers went from Bangalore to rescue dogs and, mm-hmm. you know, and they were in those little boats going to houses where that were flooded and they were rescuing. And I think those videos just went viral on Facebook. But my question, I know a lot of dog lovers are here, but I have cats, three cats at home, and I still rescue dogs. So would you say that, you know, a cat lover could also be a dog lover and dog lovers can also be cat lovers? Is it something that is acceptable to everyone?
As I said, you have to love, you know, just love every insect or animal or living being on the planet. Be it cat lover, dog lover, everyone.
Completely. We have to respect all Absolutely. Creatures on this planet. Would you like to say something? Yeah.
Is it possible to leave it for after? Because we actually really do have to wrap up.
Okay.
Oh, sorry.
Thank you.
I know we have lots of comments and questions we'd love to share, but the authors will be going up to the book signing table, which is just outside our venue, just up at the ramp, and you'll feel free to ask any questions there. I'm so sorry you have to wrap up this beautiful session. I would like to thank on behalf of the festival our wonderful panelists and our moderator. Thank you so much. Please come up. And bring the behind you.
I think all of you should go and buy these books because it's really beautifully written. If you love animals.
Absolutely.
And philosophy.
And yes, the bookstore is just next to Charbagh, the Full Circle bookstore. And please take any rubbish with you. It helps us so much. And we really, really appreciate all of your time.